Next, I would like to introduce our last speaker, Professor Dr. Thanet Pornsawan from the Preeti Phanomyong International College. You've got PhD from Binghamton University in upstate New York, United States, and his topic is Confucius. That's a short version of the whole title. Please.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, friends and colleagues, yes. First, I would like to extend my thanks to the organizing committee who graciously, you know, invite me to speak in this International Future Science Humanities Conference. Well, I heard that the reason that they invited me because they can't find anyone in Thammasat, you know, to stand in this international conference. And someone recommended, oh, I can do it, you know, in any topic, okay? So that's why I didn't have my topic here, you know, because I don't know what is the topic for the talk, you know, except the thing, okay? But actually, I prepared, you know, something, you know, to speak about today, okay? Next, please. Okay, so I think that will be my topic for today. Why there is no theory of revolution in the East? Okay. Well, this is something that been in the back of my mind, you know, for many, many years, just starting when I was student here in political science. And then I went to have my, you know, the BA in America, University of Rochester. So I've been, you know, wondering, you know, I mean, looking, you know, both, you know, West and East, you know, Asian and Europe and America for a long, long time, you know. When we start studying, you know, about the history of political thought, political ideas, we end up learning, you know, mostly from Western political ideas. You can see, you know, major political thinkers, you know, starting from Plato, Aristotle, Polybius, Cicero, St. Augustine, St. Thomas Aquinas, Machiavelli, Martin Luther, John Calvin, James Harrington, Milton, Thomas Hobbes, Locke, Rousseau, blah, 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 you know. You can have it, you know, everyone, I think, who study social science, you have to encounter some of these, you know, lectures. But if you count, you know, how many Eastern thinkers, you know, appear in your lectures, you know, I tried to think, you know, the other night, you know. Okay, number one, Confucius, the Indian maybe Manu, you know, who write the Thammasat, you know, laws, you know. Lord Buddha should be, you know, included, you know, the Thai, you know, world, you know, contest, you know. Okay. And the last one, Mao Zedong. Okay. But seriously, I think Mao is not the Eastern political thinker. His revolution is much more, you know, Western-oriented socialist revolution, so we can, you know, let it out from this talk. Okay, yeah. So it's clear, yeah, from my, you know, brief, you know, survey, you know, that yeah, there's no major, you know, theoretician of revolution in the East. Okay, but so. So what? What's the problem with my question? We want to discuss, you know, that nothing wrong with, if you look at the long history and teaching, you know, people still, you know, I mean, you know, happy, and you know, you can see now, you know, Confucianism, you know, brought back, you know, become flourishing in China. Okay, imagine that, you know, the Confucianism, you know, during Mao's era, you know, been wiped out, you know, gone, you know, temples, you know, demolished, you know. But now, you know, everyone, you know, proclaim, you know, to be a good Confucianist disciple. Actually, you know, the big institute that China export to everywhere, you know, including Thailand, is the so-called, you know, the Confucius Institute, you know, okay, to teach, you know, the Chinese language and culture. Okay, okay, next. Yeah. Okay, bring to my, you know, the question again, you know. Well, if you look, you know, at these ideas, plural ideas, you know, interestingly, you know, most schools of plural ideas, you know, both West and East. Initially, you know, outlined the similar concept of a virtuous leader as the prerequisite concept of a virtuous for a good government. Okay, so this is the, we can say that in the beginning, like a 5th BC, you know, the Lord Buddha, Plato, Socrates, Confucianism, you know, they have similar idea that government should be done by good leader, virtuous leader. Okay, you're not gonna count, you know, any commoners, you know, how many, you know, are gonna come to do that job, you know, good. Okay, no one contests about that, you know. Okay, quickly, you know, by the 15th century, okay, something happened. Okay, in the West, gradually, you know, the plural ideas, you know, had departed, you know, from the ancient political concept of virtuous political leader. Now, I mean, the teacher, philosopher, and later, you know, political leaders in Europe, mainly, you know, we look at, you know, in Europe, okay, start to talk about new group of people, new power, how to share and give some power to the so-called people to make it big, you know. Okay. So what happened, okay, in Europe? We don't have time to discuss about the detail of the history, so we're going to move next. Okay. But on the Eastern Front, however, the ancient concept of a traditional form of government, good leader, good government, you know, virtuous, you know, kondi, kondi, silitam, blah, 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 okay? Righteous leader, tosmit lachatam, okay, has been kept alive despite the impact and pressures from many parts of the world, okay? So, next, yeah. Let me give a more concrete discussion of, let's take a look at the ancient wisdom, okay? This is one, you know, teaching by Confucius, Kongzhi. Okay, he said, when one rules by means of virtue, it is like the North Star. It dwells in its place, and the other star pays reverence to it. The same thing, if you have the right one, you know, the others will follow, okay? Next. So Confucius' teaching, you know, we look at his social philosophy was based primarily on the principle of ren, or loving others, while exercising self-discipline. He believed that ren could be put into action using golden rule. What you do not wish for you yourself, do not do to others. Okay, from Lun Yi. Okay. Well, in Thai we can have this too, this teaching, you know. If you don't want them, something bad to you, you know, don't do bad things to others, you know. Actually, you know, to my surprise, you know, later on, you know, I think Immanuel Kant, you know, Kant, the famous European 19th century, you know, political philosopher, also have something similar to this, you know, principle. This is what the famous, his principle on so-called categorical imperative. He has very difficult philosophy, you know, but you just remember one line, you know, this one, you know, and this is the same thing, you know. If you don't wish something bad to you, you know, don't do the bad thing to others, okay. But the difference between Confucius, Buddhist, and other Asian, you know, saying and Kant is that Kant is purely, you know, based on individuals, judgment and action. But when Confucius and Buddhist teaching about the same line, individuals is in the collective organization. They don't emphasize the individuals, but it emphasizes the collective. Okay. But by the time 19th century, you know, Kant and Hegel and other people, you know, is the individual now count. Okay. Oh, all right. Next. Yeah. Okay, now we a little bit with Confucius' plural belief, okay, to make it more clearer, okay. So his belief based on the concept of self-discipline. Okay, this is clearly, you know, I mean, the demarcation between the Eastern and the West, you know, that the East always emphasize, you know, yourself, ourselves, actually, you know, okay. Discipline yourself, okay. He believed that a leader needed to exercise self-discipline in order to remain humble and treat his followers with compassion. In doing so, he would lead by positive example. So according to Confucius, leaders could motivate their subjects to follow the law by teaching them virtue and the untying force of visual propriety. Later, I will show you his five philopaties, relationships, okay. Mm-hmm. But for now, we can see that, I mean, the ancient wisdom, you know, I mean, work, you know, both, you know, East and West, you know, because the need next for the so-called social order, for the healthy functioning of society, common beliefs are needed. For civilization to emerge, stability was not enough. It had to be combined with initiative which was a reconciliation of individual enterprise with communal conservatism. Political ideas that elaborate on the relations between the rural and the rural in order to create an effective government. Okay, now next we're gonna switch back to you to see another ancient wisdom. Okay, next, yeah. Okay. All men are by nature equal. Make all of the same earth by one workman, okay? And however, we deceive ourselves as clear unto God is the poor peasant and his mighty prince. Next, okay. This is a quote from the famous Plato philosopher Plato, I think, from the Republic. Dictatorship naturally allows out of democracy, and the most elaborated form of tyranny and slavery out of the most extreme liberty. Okay, it's clear, I mean, you can see that Plato is not very friendly to democracy and the idea of liberty. Okay, but anyway, I mean, you can see that, I mean, the discussion of, you know, government is the combined, you know, I mean, involving, you know, the masses and the ruler. Okay, they're not much on the one single, you know, the leader. Even though Plato still believe in this whole philosopher king. Okay, next. Okay, this one is about democracy. It's a charming form of government, full of variety and disorder, and dispensing a sort of equality to equals and unequals alike. It's amazing, I mean, that in that time, you know, the Greek, you know, philosophers already, you know, discussed the so-called, you know, form of government, including democracy, that, I mean, you know, allow, you know, equality for other people, you know. Next. Okay, so now this is Aristotle, you know. He who is unable to live in society, or who has no need because he is sufficient for himself, must be either a beast or a god. So Aristotle is the one who made politics, you know, virtue. Without politics, you know, man is not better than animals. Okay. So now you can see, you know, I mean, that the Greek thinkers, you know, and the ancient thinkers, you know, I mean, they're looking different. Their perception of human and nature, you know, different now. Okay. Next. I'm not going to go into detail of the Aristotle, you know, theory of knowledge, you know, but just bring it up, you know what I mean, because I think this guy is the key to later, if I try to answer, you know, why there's no, you know, theory of revolution in the East, and I think Aristotle is the key to that answer. Next. Okay, this is the famous, I mean, painter by Raphael, you know, later 18th, 19th century, you know. The picture of, you know, famous Greek city life, you know, and, I mean, you know, how flourishing political ideas, you know, So this is the school of, you know, Athens. Okay, next. So by the time of, you know, Aristotle, you know, and into the Roman period, you know, we can say that, you know, some kind of theory of revolution, you know, already formed, you know. This is from Plato's Politics Book 5, when he discusses about, you know, change and the revolution, okay. Well, in the Greek world, you know, politics, you know, there was no word, you know, definite word for revolution, okay. There's a word that Plato used, metabolic proletarian. I'm not Greek, you know, so I cannot pronounce, you know, this is what you can see, okay. But that's close to the meaning of, you know, cycle of constitution, that means change of government. So it's not the revolution, not, you know, but simply the change of constitutions. By Aristotle's time, you know, I mean, there's a word, you know, that clearly, you know, I mean, pick up, you know, the change, you know, the political change. And can you go to the next one? Yeah, okay. Okay, by the time of Polybius and Cicero, you know, the Roman developed the word for social political change. Neoterismos, okay, mean overthrow by force. Another word is res nova. Change of regime either by the coup or revolt. So it clearly, you know, by Roman times, you know, the concept depicting, because there were so many, I mean, coup and revolution happened in the Republic of Rome and the Empire of Roman Empires, you know, so no doubt that someone had to write, you know, and Polybius wrote a lot of his, you know, history, you know, tried to explain. So that's why social change came up, okay. And next, okay. Okay, so this, the concept coming from Aristotle politics, okay, we can see clearly that now he can see different forms of government. But monarchy, aristocracy, democracy, the major forms, you know, I mean, the cycle, you know, I mean, from one to the other, you know, okay. So we can see that, you know, by the Greek and Roman, you know, political thinkers already saw that, I mean, it's natural for government, you know, to change from one form to the other. You don't have to stick to one only, okay. But even at this question, this idea, you know, I think it never happened to Asian thinkers, okay? We always think that's only one form. If we have so many changes, but it always comes back to the same or similar form. That means to rule by the one only, okay? So from Aristotle analysis, you know, in this book, you know, I mean, he even, you know, try to formulate, you know, kind of, you know, how to deal with, you know, this social change, because normally people don't want, you know, drastic changes, you know, by forces, by, you know, it's disrupted, you know, the cycle of life and economy and everything, okay? So he tried to offer his, you know, ideas and how to avoid, you know, a revolt or a revolution. Okay, the propositions. Number one, limit power of ruling group. Okay. Number two, contain power of clique. Okay, the same thing, you know, so many cliques, factions in the ruling class. Number three, no corruption. Okay. Number four, you have to build trust among the people to rule. Okay. I mean, if you ask political scientists nowadays, you know, this is everywhere, in every, you know, theory, Simon, Huntington, or blah, 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 you know, whoever write about, you know, political science nowadays, you know, they have these four things that Aristotle proposes. And even the constitution, I think, you know, also included a major idea from these four, you know, I mean, principles, you know. But, let me add, just for fun, you know, I think these four, you know, mostly rejected by the Thai constituents. Maybe in the beginning, you know, 1932 and 1946, I think constitution that still retained some kind of division of power, you know. But after 1949, and exception is 1997, most of the Thai constitution, you know, left out the number one. Instead, you know, they try to write how to limit the power of your opponents. Don't limit your power, not the ruling power, but your enemy's power. And that's it, the constitution. Okay, next please. Now, we look, you know, back again, coming to the East, government in the East. I think the classic question is still the same one, then and now. Power should stay with the one or the many. And back and forth, okay? But most of the time, I think the answer is with number one, is the one, the many, with exception. Okay, you can see coming soon in this theater. And according to Confucius, you know, politics, state, you know, is extension of a family. It's just a big family, okay? It's not national, I mean, organization. It's not something virtuous, you know, that Aristotle tried to teach us, you know? I mean, we never listen to Aristotle anyway, you know, just recently, okay? Yeah. So Philon, Petty, you know, Confucius, the famous, you know, five relations, okay? Three of his social relations, you know, situated based in the family, okay? Husband and wife, children and parents, you know, daughter and brothers, you know, da-da-da, you know. So more than half, you know, is how, you know, people in the family, you know, have to take care of your own people, okay? One relation, you know, in society with your friends, dealing with the other, with the friends, okay? One with the state. Okay, proper relation with the government. Okay, the government good, then you obey. Government bad, overthrow them, easy. But that's why they don't need a theory, you know, because it already built in, you know, this big relation. Okay, next. And also, you know, I think the idea of parties also informed by, you know, the goal of society, social goals. Okay, so clearly, you know, I mean, most of ancient thinkers, you know, believe in the same thing, harmony, samanachan, samakhi, okay, reconciliation, whatever, okay, the same concept for 2,000 years, 4,000 years, okay. Politics is not the goal, okay, it's harmony, unity, the social order, okay. Mm-hmm. Government is the administration of correctness. Straight, this is from Confucius. If the government is straight, you know, why people will be, you know, disorder? Okay. So if you're right, you know, the other people cannot be unruly. Mm-hmm. Logically, I mean, it's correct. I mean, you can't argue with that, you know. But in practice, it's always difficult. Okay. So emphasis is always upon the ruler and tradition. Okay, the Confucius is based upon his traditional, you know, belief, and you know, he always look back to the golden era, you know, before the Zhou, the Nazi, you know, I mean, there's something good, you know, but at his time, you know, Chinese kingdom entered, you know, this disruption, rebellious, okay. So, if it was you, you know, is the most important, you know, is the unifying force, okay. But next, actually, you know, I found one, you know, I mean, Confucius disciple, you know, many later, you know, Mozhu. Mozhu probably was the only one who, I mean, departed from the mainstream, you know, Confucius teaching, you know. He emphasized on the people, especially in the economic hardships, in injustice, I mean, because of economic, you know, disparities, you know. So he said, people is very important, you know. And the people, you know, including, you know, the whole humanity, okay? Next, please. Now we come to closer to Thailand, the Buddhist worldview. Okay. Buddhism also negates the centrality of individuals in the social realities. I mean, if you're familiar with Buddhist teaching and practices, it's clear that, I mean, the social milieu, the dimension of society, you know, in the Buddhist practice and teaching, you know, is really hard to find. Okay. Well, I mean, that is the society in the Buddhist teaching, I don't deny that. But we're talking about the impact and the popular belief and practices, and including in the plural, the interaction that exploit in the Buddhist teaching, you know. I think they left out, you know, the so-called social aspect of Buddhist, you know, practices, you know. So Buddhism, you know, emphasize, this is the, I pick up from the, I mean, you know, the teaching of various, I mean, you know, famous Buddhist thinker, and you know, so not from the Tripitaka Pathayabhidhaka, okay? So don't argue that this is not the word that mentioned in the Tripitaka, okay? But this is the what his the disciple, you know, explained to people, okay? So this version of Buddhism will emphasize, you know, the wisdom that well, human being, you know, is good because you can extinguish your dukkha, you know, your suffering, you know, and enter nirvana, enlightenment, okay? So you see, I mean, instead of trying to figure out, you know, what's wrong with our social realities, you know, if you stick to this teaching, you know, forget it, you know, it's a mess there. Go there, that's enlightenment, you know. The future is enlightened. Don't look to the back, you know, the back is all dirty, okay? But this is a very, you know, casual, you know, I mean, comparison, you know, okay, not that deep, okay. But anyway, so bring to my political comparison, you know, I think this political idea, Buddhist idea, is opposite to the so-called Western Enlightenment thought that gave rise to the liberal idea of democracy. Okay, so all the ideas of, you know, Montesquieu or constitution, you know, separation of power, balance of power, you know. It has no popular, you know, influence in the mind of the Buddhist, I mean, teaching about what people should do, what people should follow, you know, and they're deeply ingrained in our soul that we are, you know, going to extinguish. We're not going to stick to something, you know, transient, okay? Power is transient, you know, so we don't leave it, okay? Next. Okay. All right, so I think I gave enough my comparison of why there is no theory of liberation, social change, you know, a real one, you know, in the East, okay? And, well, this is a conclusion that I decide I'm not going to use it, you know, but it's nice to look at it, okay? Because it has a good word, you know, from Kipling, you know, East is East, West is West, and never the twain shall meet. I don't like the ending because it makes you like a, so you can romanticize with your past, you know. So we are what we are. You are what you were. So we just depart. So I think I'm gonna change my conclusion. It occurred to me that that's one, you know, the piece of writing by Walter Benjamin, you know, the famous the German philosopher. He wrote a piece on the angel and history, you know, drawing from Paul Klee's famous picture of the angel, you know, the frightening by, you know, something, you know, that made his wings, you know, I mean, frozen in the air. Okay. And Benjamin, you know, described that picture, you know. He said, that the same thing, like, I mean, now, you know, the wagon of progress, you know, moving, you know, into the future, you know, with human looking, you know, back, you know, from what I mean, you know, the chariot took him in, you know, to the future. He saw the calamities, you know, destruction in front of him. But he cannot stop. The wind of progress move him into the future. And that's it. We are moving by the force of modernity into the future that we do not see. Thank you.